You survived that introduction? Yes, sir. If you don't behave tonight, I'll have her come to your home. And you will get delivered. Yeah, she'll get that nasty stuff out. Welcome to streamers. Thank you for tuning in tonight. Got a good Bible study for you. The next seminar is at the end of the month. Please remember the radio programs are on every day in the morning and the afternoon, and you can catch them all the time on soundcloud.com/hardcore-christianity. If you'd like to help the ministry out and you don't have any money, you can do so. Just switch over from Google to Good Search and put our name in, Hardcore Christianity, and they'll donate to our ministry every time you search for something on the internet, and hopefully you're not searching for anything you shouldn't be searching for. Every service here is always on livestream.com. So if you can't make it here personally, you can get healed or delivered right over the on the internet. Okay? Happens all the time. All right. Have you ever wondered why some people have such a huge anointing and most people don't? Have you ever wondered that? Can you hear me now? He says he can't hear me. Can you hear me back there? Yeah. Okay. Have you ever wondered why some people have such a huge anointing and most people don't? No? I always wondered that. They've been to pottery class. They took a pottery class. I'm going to give you one tonight, a graduate level course. Now, when you get into a pottery class and you're an amateur, you just make little things like ashtrays. But later on, when you get advanced, you start making some pretty impressive stuff in the pottery class. It takes skill, it takes time, it takes perseverance, it takes determination to go from making ashtrays to making fancy statues or whatever. It takes some time to develop skills. Okay. How does that work spiritually? Let's find out. Check out Jeremiah chapter 18. It says, the word of the Lord came to Jeremiah, saying, go down to the potter's house. There I will cause you to hear my words. And I went down, and behold, I saw a work on the wheels. And the vessel that he made of clay was marred in the hands of the potter. He made it again into another vessel that seemed good to the potter. Oh, Lord. This verse is anti-American. We like to manage our own lives and do whatever we darn well please. Unfortunately, that's the opposite of getting an anointing from God, doing whatever you darn well please. If you're that type of person, your anointing potential is next to zero. You are virtually guaranteed to be a total spiritual loser. Your future is bleak, to say the least. Why? The potter decides what to make out of a marred vessel. Oh, man. When you get saved, your spirit man is born again, and you are perfect in the eyes of God. Absolutely perfect. And the Holy Spirit moves into your spirit man. You become a born-again Christian. The Greek phrase is geneo anathen. Jesus said you must be born again. It's an absolute requirement. You must be geneo anathen, generated or born from above. When you open your heart and receive Christ, he comes from above and enters your spirit man. Unfortunately, the spirit man is in mint condition, but the rest of the person, marred. They've still got soul issues, emotional problems, emotional pain, emotional frustrations, inappropriate passion, rage, anger issues coming out of the soul. Their bodies may not be healed. They may have scars from injuries, pain from accidents, industrial injuries, personal accidents, car wrecks, congenital issues. The body's marred, soul marred. The mind, oh, massively marred. It takes sometimes years and sometimes decades for some Christians to renew their minds in Christ. Literally takes decades. They're that slow of learners, that indifferent to God, that uninterested. It takes decades to renew their mind. They're marred. But this marred person got on the wheel, and the potter made it into something he chose. Then the word of the Lord came to him and said, O house of Israel, cannot I do with you like this potter did, says Jehovah? As the clay is in the potter's hand, so are you in my hands. And there you are, marred and mucky, messed up. Now you're coming along here, see? How'd you come along? You stayed on the wheel. Oh. Brother Mike, he's deep. 2 Timothy chapter 2. Nevertheless, the foundation of God stands sure. Here's my seal. God knows those who are his. Yeah, you can fool some of the people all the time, and you can fool all the people some of the time, but you can't fool all the people all the time. You gotta kind of keep doing it differently, as they say in the marketing field. God knows you and knows those that are his. And the ones that aren't his are the ones still living in iniquity. Ooh. Why? These people jumped off the wheel. In a big house, megas, huge. That's the term you would use for a big old house, like a mansion. You wouldn't use that, let's say, for a mobile home. Single family mobile home. Portable mobile home. You wouldn't use that. I know real estate too. Don't worry about it. See, in a big old house, heaven, God's kingdom, so to speak, there are many kinds of vessels. Some of them are made out of gold. Wow, great. Silver. Oh, yes. Oh, no. Oh, some of them are wood. Oh, some of them are made out of dirt. Some are honorable. Some are dishonorable. If a man or woman purges themselves from these, they will be a vessel of honor. How do you become a vessel of honor? You got to stay on the wheel. And they will then become hagios, set apart, sanctified, set over here for God. And Eucharistos, easily used for their master's use for every good work. How do you get easy to use? You stay on that wheel, don't you? You were a marred clump when you first got saved. Spirit man in perfect condition. Oh, you were beautiful. You still are beautiful. But some of the other parts of you, in fact, it was gag me with a spoon, kind of stuff. I see some of you have eaten bad Mexican food as well. How do you become good work? There's only one way to do it. You got to stay on that wheel. And you don't decide. The potter decides. People who decide for themselves in life end up with lives that suck.
miserable, unfulfilled lives of chronic conflict and strife and fighting, disappointment, sorrows, and miseries frequently follow them because they decided to potter themselves. When you potter yourselves, you become a potted plant that somebody forgets to water. You fizzle out. Pottering yourself is unchristian. In 1 Corinthians chapter 3, there's only one foundation, and that would be the Savior, Christ the Lord. And if you build upon that foundation, which is you, gold, yay, silver, precious stone, that's what we're looking for. Oh no, Zulon, some of it's timber. Timber's good, but it can burn. Cortos, pasture land, that's good, but that dries out under certain circumstances. Kalame, grain stalks are good, but after the harvest season, they don't look too good. But they're all in the same house, big house. Notice that? Interesting. Every man's work shall be made manifest, for the day of the Lord will declare it. What's that shocker? Every one of you have an inescapable appointment with God. Not one soul gets a pass. Every human being, sinner or saint, has to give an account of their life to God. Nobody gets out of it. Not even one. If one got out, then they should all get out. Because God would not be just, would he? If he let one guy go, he'd be like our crooked judges and lawyers running around Maricopa County. They're all a bunch of lying thieves. They'll give this one person and then they won't give it to that one. Father's not that kind of a judge. No, every single person here in this planet has an inescapable appointment that they will have to meet someday. Every single one of us. We can't get out of it. And when we get there, what happens if you're a born-again Christian? Well, the fire comes to your house. You got fire coming. Not hellfire. Not that kind of fire. That went away at Calvary. When you became a born-again Christian, your spirit man, boom, perfecto. And hell left you forever. There's another fire coming to your life. If you're a born-again Christian, what would it be? Let's see. The fire shall, dokimazo, test every man or woman's work to find out what the heck it is. Now, if, not when, if any man work, mano, remains, which he built. How'd you build your works? Well, you stayed on that wheel. And you let him choose what you became. Here in America, we don't do that. Americans, they want to choose everything themselves. It's all about us here. We're the greatest country in the world. If you don't believe it, ask everybody. We go around telling that to everybody. Maybe if we switched that, wouldn't have so many people wanting to come here. But we market it that way, so why wouldn't you want to come here? I don't mean here, Phoenix. Don't come here now. It's some hot out there. That's real heat now. But there's fire coming in your future that's not like our heat. If your work remains, and some will not, correct?
If means some won't and some will, correct?
Correct.
If means it's burned. What does that mean? Katakayo. It's when a house burns down, when a forest burns down, burns to nothing. It's ashes. That's happening in Arizona and California right now, all over the place. In fact, there's one out in Apache Junction right now, isn't there? One busted out yesterday or something, north of Pet. And he will suffer loss, but your spirit man saved. You're born again, and you get through, even though none of your works did. You have to go through, dear, you got to go through the fire to get into glory. Every single one of you have an inescapable appointment that can't be avoided. You will never get out of it. Neither will I. It's on the other side of the fire. What's Father trying to tell us here with these verses? Quite a bit, I think. Psalms chapter 32. Thus saith the Lord, don't be like a horse, and don't be like a, what? A mule. That's what some of you are like, stubborn as mules. You know who you are. Don't raise your hands. Mules and horses, they don't understand the big picture of life. They just do what they're told. You hope. You got to put a bit in their mouths. Lead them around like a dumb animal. Many sorrows shall be to wicked people. Oh, are you kidding me? This is a country of sorrowful, sad Christians. They're sicker than dogs. Biggest shock I ever had in my life was when I switched over from counseling secularly to Christian counseling, and I couldn't believe it. I couldn't believe it. When I found out that the Christians had the same problems the sinners had, I couldn't believe it. Same sicknesses, same mental illnesses, same emotional problems. I like to faint it. I don't know what I was thinking. Maybe I thought I was like Dorothy getting out of the off the house and looking around. Oh, it's colorful here. We're not in Kansas anymore. No, I was still in Kansas when I got into the Christian counseling. Couldn't believe it. They were sorrowful like wicked people. You trust in the Lord, mercy shall follow you, it says. Matthew 16. What does it profit? What does a man profit if he shall gain the whole cosmos, human world, and lose his soul? What would you give in exchange for your soul? He says, for the Son of Man shall come in the glory of Father with his angels, and he will reward every man and woman for their works. Somebody is coming to visit you. Who would that be? Let's find out. 2 Corinthians chapter 5 says, we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ. Why? Whatever you did through your body. Your body, in a way, is like a conduit for an electrician. You know, the wires go through the conduit from the box to the sockets. Your body's a conduit of the Holy Ghost, and it's also a conduit of demons and all kinds of things. And so your body then oozes out what's in there. And on your judgment day, God examines what you did with your body. Whether it's good or bad, what'd you do with your body? Well, let's look at these seven types. There's a gold. There's silver, there's timber, clay, precious stones, quartz, pasture land, or stubble, grain stalks. Who are all these? These are born-again Christians. They're all born-again Christians. Each born-again Christian has used their body differently in their Christian life. Some ruined it. Some, love you. Some people wrecked it. Some people took care of it. Some people used it for sin. Some people used it for the Lord. Everybody different, like fingerprints. These are all Christians. You got pasture land type Christians. They look good from a distance. Put any kind of pressure on them, ooh, or any heat at all, boy, they turn yellow. They burn out and blow away. Oh boy. Stubble, oh, that doesn't last long. Wood can be burned. Rome was built out of clay. Oh, that thing burned to the ground. Man. What are you doing that won't be burned down on the day of your appointment with the Savior? What are you doing with your body that won't be burned down? Some works in God's eyes are golden works. Yeah. Some works are hay and stubble.
Yep, that's right.
Here's a bunch of TV preachers with mansions and limousines. That stuff gets burned up, fizzles out like hay quick. What are you in the mood for? Gold, silver, hay, stubble? What you like? What's checking out? Luke 22 says, Simon, Satan has, mistranslated. Exateo. He demanded to have you. The devil hated Peter more than anybody. You know why? Had a big mouth. Ma. There are many of them kind of Christians. Run their mouths like busted chainsaws, but can't pray their way out of a paper bag. You ever seen that? Know everything about the Bible. Had never led a soul to Christ. Never prayed for him. Nobody healed. You ever met any one of those blowhard Christians? Oh, they know everything about it. You look at their fruit and it's virtually non-existent. Peter. Blah, 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 blah. Blah, 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 blah. I pissed the devil off. He's proud. He's arrogant. He runs his mouth. I don't like him. I hate his guts. That's the one I want. He went to Jehovah and said, give me that one. I'll teach him a lesson he won't forget. Jesus knew what was happening. How did he do that? I don't know. I don't know what went on behind the scenes or how he got that information, but he sure got it. But guess what happened here, which is quite amazing, quite remarkable. Jesus didn't pray for him that it not happen. He didn't pray that Peter didn't go through tough times. Jesus didn't pray for him that things would go well and easy for him. Did he? No. Something fascinating happened here. What was that? He prayed that his faith wouldn't fail while he had to go on the wheel. American Christians are the opposite. They pray just the opposite. They spend all their time praying, Lord, get me the heck out of here. Stop it. Help. Quit. That's American Christianity. Jesus said, no, wait a minute. Peter, we're not quitting nothing. I'm praying for your faith as you go through it, that it won't fail. Very odd prayer. Is it really odd? Ah, in fact, it was the best prayer. See, you're on the wheel right now and you're thinking about hopping off. I don't blame you. I'm just like you. I'm a regular person too. I don't particularly like tough times either, but if you hop off that wheel, you will miss your destiny. You will lose your call from God. You will develop hay and stubble. I don't know about you, but I'd rather not be known as stubble. That don't even sound good. I demand to have that big mouth loser. You might get him, but I'm praying for this. Jesus outfox the devil. It takes faith to stay on the potter's wheel and not jump off. It takes trust. Trusting is the only way. Because what you see and what you feel while you're on that wheel is telling you everything but faith and trust. Every crappy, ugly, stinky, filthy thing happening to you is telling you, hey, I got to get out of here. And Father's saying, stay on that wheel. I chose what you are to become, not you. American Christians. They don't like to be on potter's wheels. They like to do what they want, when they want, how they want. In fact, they dole out them prayers just exactly like that. Lord, here's what I want, and here's what I need, and here's how I want you to do it. They even pray sinful prayers. Lord, take my husband down and kick his ass. And then heal him, Lord. You throw in your mercy when you're done giving him a good whipping. Those prayers are never answered. Father's saying, whoa, check it. Stay on that wheel. I got something bigger than you could even imagine right over there. And Peter, when you are epistrepho, reconverted. My God. After you're off the wheel, help your brethren. You don't understand, do you? You can't help somebody unless you've been through something yourself. What the devil meant for you for a truckload of hell and high water, Father meant for you for good. Because you chose to stay on the wheel. Many of you have already jumped off. Get back on. Yeah, it is tough. Yeah, there's some pain there. Peter took it bad. He took him a hard country whipping. But on the day of Pentecost, he did not remember any of them whippings. All he saw was 3,000 souls in one day. Luke 22. Peter's listening to Jesus talk about the end. The Jews and the Romans are going to butcher me and murder me and chop me to shreds. They're going to kill me. He goes, oh, wait a minute here. He starts talking to the devil again. He doesn't know it. The devil heard him say this. Hey, no. Count me in. I'm in. Blah, 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 blah. You see, when you're not going through it on the potter's wheel, it's easy to run your mouth. Oh, that big talk is cheap. Until you're, somebody's working the clay off of you. Anybody can run their mouths. Ask your spouse. I'll go to even prison with you. Oh, that ain't Sheriff Joe. Sheriff Joe, that's cake duty. Yeah, it's hot out there. Yeah, you get a big old sub sandwich and 99% of it's bread. Yeah, you can read through the little piece of ham on it. That's true. those prisons back then, they were torture chambers. You see what he's telling the devil here? He's, oh, I'm in. No problem. See, it's easy to be in when you've jumped off the wheel. Faith comes easy when you feel good. Those are fair weather Christians. You ever heard of them? Oh, it's nice out today. I'm saved. Oh, God, this is tough. I'm backsliding. Jesus, John 15. I, the Lord said, I am the true vine, and my Father, he's the one who trims the vines and collects the fruit and prunes the fruit. Every branch in me, each born again Christian is in Christ. Did you know that? You're in Christ. Now your body might be sinning, your mind might be all jacked up right now, but your spirit man is in Christ. You are a child of God, whether you're going through a tough time or not. That's the truth. What kind of fruit branches we got here? What kind of fruit's going on? What does he say here? Well, it says every branch that's in me, that's a born-again Christian for sure. That's not a sinner. We know that by definition, don't we? Only a few know that. If you're not a born-again Christian, you're not in Christ, are you? Okay. Thank you. However, some born-again Christians don't bear any spiritual fruit. Why? They jumped off the wheel. If you don't bear any fruit and you're a born-again Christian, you could be, I wrote, removed. Everyone that bears fruit, born-again Christian, by definition, correct? Father does what? Cathyro, he purges it, he cleans it, he cleanses it, he trims it, he shapes it up. How's he doing that? Those are the ones that stay on the wheel. They don't jump off. People call me all the time, Brother Mike, pray for me because this is hit the fan and then that hit it too. I go, I will pray for you. I don't pray like they want me to. They want me to pray to get rid of it. I don't. I pray, Father, trim that off and keep that thing. When they're going through tough times, I know what's up. The Holy Ghost, he's up to a masterpiece. But he's working on it here. But it ain't a masterpiece out there. I said, Lord, help them get through it. Because they're going here. Look at that face. Why does he do that? Why does he purge it and clean it, cleanse it, trim it up, shape it up? He wants more fruit. Father's a fruit addict. He thinks about it all the time. The Holy Ghost is always looking at one of his sons and daughters saying, how can I get more fruit out of her? How can I get more fruit? How about her? What can I do? He's addicted to fruit. John 15 again. Now you are Gathros. You've been cleansed. See? If you're a born again Christian, your spirit man is in perfecto condition. Clean as a whistle, as my granddad used to say. Through what? God's holy word, the logos, the full word of God. What full word of God? What I shared with you. Remain in me and let me remain in you. Why? Because branches cannot bear fruit by itself. Jesus Christ, the Son of God, is not going to come down here to the house of healing and walk through that door and heal one cotton picking person tonight. Where do you think he is tonight? Hanging around the house of healing? Dude, he's in glory at the right hand of the Father. And God only knows how many, whatever's up there, are worshiping him tonight. He sent you the Holy Ghost. He told you to do it. Well, that's apostasy. Is it? Well, I'll read it again. The branch cannot bear fruit of itself. It doesn't say the vine's doing it. Branches do it. You as a branch. No offense. You can't bear fruit by yourself, so we must remain in the vine. The vine's not going to do it, and the branch can't do it. So it's a combo job. Yeah. You've seen those before, haven't you? I'll order the number 5 combo. That's the fish one over there. You get the sandwich. You get the French fries. You get to drink. Don't you know what a combo is? This is a combo job. See, the vine is not going to do it by himself. He busy in glory. He sent you the Holy Ghost, and you are his branches. You are. You are. I know what you think. I live my life like a stump. You're going to repent tonight, and you're going to get back on that wheel and start trimming some of that crap out. No offense, but we've got some crappy Christians here tonight that needed to get back on the wheel so Father can honor that masterpiece. You have to remain in the vine. Main though. You can't do anything except you remain in me, of course. John 15. I am the vine. You are the branches. You. Branches. What are we after here? Father's addiction. Fruit. Jesus said, I always do those things that please him. What pleases Father? The vine using this branch to generate fruit. The vine is not going to do it. Father's not going to do it. He's busy tonight somewhere in glory on his throne. He sent you here. You got the Holy Ghost. You're the branch. He told you to do it. You don't want to remain in the vine? Uh-oh. Balo. Thrown exo. Completely out. Thrown out the door. What? You get off that wheel and you have left Father's will for your life. You are now on your own will. You're now the boss. You want to do everything yourself? Out. Out. Get out. Oh, that's cruel. I don't care what you call it. I'm just reading it. Okay, don't get mad at me and don't send me an email. I'm just reading things. Streamers, don't bother. Don't get upset at me. You are ballo, thrown completely out. And then what happens to you when you go out? When you do it your way, eventually you will wither to nothing. which is what some of you are right now, spiritually withered. Nothing. You're stumps now, but you're going to get out of your chair tonight and you're going to get back on the potter's wheel. That's what you're going to do. I don't want to wither. Branches that are attached to the vine bring forth Father's joy. Father loves fruit. Boy, he loves fruit. Well, if you get out of the vine and you go your own direction, guess what happens? Jesus said it's similar to vines that have lost their branches here in agriculture. Look, they gather the things up. They're dead. They withered out. Then what do you do with them? You got to get rid of them. See, they didn't have wood chippers back then. Now you get a wood chipper. Yeah, and it goes through the wood chipper and then it's recycled. Back then you just burned it. Men throw them into the fire and they are burned. Burned branches that leave the vine, the ones that don't want to be on the potter's wheel because they want to potter themselves, end up withered and burned up. That isn't any good. John 15, if, which means you might or you might not, if you may not remain in me and my words may not remain in you, you shall what? See, had Peter been on the wheel, he wasn't. He's just running his mouth. He thought he was on the wheel. A lot of Christians have big egos. They think they're doing something when they're not. He thought he was on the wheel, but he wasn't. Had he been on the wheel, he would have prayed the same prayer Jesus prayed. Had he been on the wheel, he'd have prayed the same prayer. Don't take me out of that, but help my faith get me through it. Two or three of you are having something good happen to you right now. You're thinking back just for a second while I'm talking. And you're thinking back about something that happened to you that was unpleasant. And you're going, wait a minute here. I tried my best to get away from that, them, her, him, it. Maybe I shouldn't have been so hasty. Maybe I did jump off that wheel too soon. Father loves fruit. And when you produce the branches, son's fruit, guess who gets the glory? Father's glorified. When you bear what? Father loves fruit. My daughter Tracy loves fruit. You can hear her howling back there. Thank you, sweetie. I'm part of her fruit. She brought me to Jesus. I'm a fruit. You see, bankrupt, carnal, loser Christians don't produce fruit. And by definition, they are then not what? Disciples. They're only Christians. They don't produce spiritual fruit. Why? They jumped off the wheel. Oh. Things got a little hot for them. And I'm out of here. And Father was praying Hold it. Just stay right there. I got a couple things to show you. I got a couple things for you to learn. I got some revelations for you. Yeah, it's a little tough right now, but don't jump off that potter's wheel. I'm working on my masterpiece. I'm a masterpiece in progress. You are. If you what? Stay on that wheel. Stay there. Christians produce very little spiritual fruit. Disciples are, they got bushels of it. Father, happy. Oh, he gets happy. Father has emotions too, just like we do. Not exactly the same, but they're emotions. He's got happiness and anger and love and all kinds of things. We got our emotions from him. He created our souls. How does God do all this? How does he motivate disciples? Do you ever wonder how these super anointed people got that way? I wonder how. Let me look here. Hebrews 12. Paul is quoting Proverbs 3. He says, have you forgotten the exhortation, children? Talking to Christians here. Messianic Jews, Hebrews. My son, do not despise, Proverbs 3, the paideia, discipline. Oh, we don't like discipline because we read Dr. Spock when we were young. Just give him a time out. Well, when you give them time out, it gives them time to think of something else bad to do. Let's give them another time out so they can continue to get worse than they were before we put them in time out. Gives them time to think about how to manipulate you and get out of that the next time they screw up. Thank you, Dr. Spock. I'd like to get a hold of Dr. Spock and stop it. Stop it. Don't faint. During discipline from Father. Ekluo, don't pass out. American Christians are, they're great at that. Listen, we need to do this for the Lord, but it's going to require this sacrifice. What? Bang! Boom, they're down. 3, 4, 5. Don't pass out, dude. When you are elenco, convicted, you don't understand. You're not getting it. Conviction's the best thing in the world. Yeah. Condemnation is the worst. They're polar opposites. Yeah. Conviction comes from God. It comes from love. It comes because I care for you. Watch out, I'm protecting you. Condemnation comes from the devil, running you down and degrading you and trying to destroy your self-concept and ruin your self-esteem. Elenco is conviction from God. Convicting you, hey, whoa, don't get off the wheel. Oops, step back here. Okay, now let's go through this together. I need to build in the gold and the silver here. Hebrews 12, when the Lord loves, if he loves you, he what? He disciplines you. He's not Dr. Spock. Whom the Lord loves, he disciplines. And if necessary, in bad, really bad cases, you got to take a whipping. Must he go, a whipping? Oh, God, that's a felony. It is now. But anybody who has any common sense understood the difference between abuse and a whipping. There's a difference. He will do that if he has to, but every one of them that Father receives has to stay on that wheel. Hupomeno, if you absorb it patiently, if you hang in there, hold on. You are God's son or daughter. If you jump off that wheel, do you know what you are? You're a bastard.
Yes.
Bastards! I can say that, I'm on YouTube. Nobody cares on YouTube, trust me. What son whom the father doesn't discipline? No decent father lets their son do whatever they want. They do now, but a decent father doesn't use time out. The decent father disciplines a child, not abuses them. There's a difference. If you're without that, what are you? You are not a son. You are a bastard. Bastards, by definition, they're not even Christians, are they? Sons are born again Christians. They're children of God. We've had fathers of our flesh, Paul says. Hey, let me give you an example. Here's a human example, he says. They trained us. Our fathers trained us. And we gave them reverence. We respected them. We listened. If you're going to do that with a human father, he's saying here as an example, wouldn't you then go here to your heavenly father and be more attentive for discipline? Wouldn't you? He's saying, wouldn't you, hupotasso, subordinate yourself to father's training and discipline if you would do that for a human father? Wouldn't you that much more do that for your heavenly father? He's asking an obvious question. Yes. They verily, for a few days, they did what? They disciplined us after their own dokeo. Thoughts, desires, wants, needs, right? And you listened to them. Your father said this and that because he wanted this and that done, and you respected him and you did it, and he disciplined you and you went with it. How much more would you not then stay on the wheel for your heavenly father? Now, he says, I admit this. Paul says, hey, this disciplining thing, I get it. Sometimes it's not party on, dude, when you have to go through some stuff. While Peter was backsliding and collapsing and cussing out at the fire and running home screaming and wailing, yeah, that's not that much fun, but he got back on the wheel and ended up at Pentecost, and we're here because of it. I'm here because he got back on the wheel. Nevertheless, afterward, you get what? You get benefits of discipline and training from your heavenly father. If you stay on that wheel, yeah, there's some tough spots to go through. I'm with you. I've been there too. And guess what? To those who are exercised thereby. Now, that's a weird sentence in the Bible. It's one of the strangest ones I ever read, so I had to investigate it a little bit. And after I looked in the Greek there, gymnazo diatos. Gymnazo means to train naked. That's odd, training naked. And it's so hot in here right now, I think I'm about ready to go ahead and get naked. And that'll clear the place out quickly. Training naked was what the Olympic gymnasts did in Rome. They don't do that now. It's similar now. They wear very tight, I don't even know what those outfits are, but there's almost like nothing to them, so they don't catch on anything. What are they? They're like leotards? Is that what they are? They wear these things now, but back then they trained naked, see? And he's referencing the Olympic athletes that it says God trained them through him. You are trained, exercised and disciplined like an Olympic gymnast in Rome by your heavenly father. The gymnast followed their instructions and went to their trainers and followed the diet and followed the exercise. And that's kind of what they look like. Gymnazo, weird. But it's not a pervert thing, it's a training thing. He was using the athletic concept behind the verse saying, hey, you want to train like an Olympic athlete, i.e. become a fruit-bearing, born-again disciple? Stay on the wheel. Don't do it yourself. Don't go your own way. I'm making you. You're not making you. Now, some people don't like to train like Olympic athletes, and some people do. Now, this girl here, look, she went through a huge metamorphosis. She had to work hard to lose 200 pounds, where that was. These folks are trying. There are some Christians that are saying, hey, you know, I got to change my life here. I'm gonna start letting Father discipline me and put me into a training program. But sometimes, you know, you reach this point and you're going, I don't want to do this anymore. I'm going to get off the wheel. And that's where the tragedy comes in. See, first you collapse and then you kind of fall off the wheel. That's what happens. While you're having a great day and you're killing it, nobody jumps off the wheel. It's when you're down, you fall off. Wherefore, lift up your hands which hang down and the feeble knees. Make straight paths for your feet and let that which is lame be turned out of the way and be healed. How are we going to do that? You have to get back on the wheel tonight. Now he does it from now on, not you. See, if you run your own life, you're going to face nothing but sadness, sorrow, and disappointments and misery. Why? Because you don't have the skills. Oh, that's an insult? It isn't. It's the best blessing you've ever heard, and you don't even know it. When you recognize that you don't have the skills for your life and you've turned those over to Father, that's the best spot in the world to be. You hit it. Father has got you on this wheel. And he's making all kinds of different vessels out of gold, silver, precious stones. If you jump off the wheel and try and do it on your own, hay, stubble, grass, dirt, man, no good. Why do people get off the wheel sometimes? Man, they get scared. They get scared. You know why they get scared? The devil tricks them. He tells them, this is a pretty tough section of your life, isn't it, buddy? Yeah, it is. Well, it's going to get worse. He always says that. You know why? Because he's read these verses. He knows Father's got you on the wheel there. And the devil doesn't know how he's doing it because he's not that smart. He does stuff and he thinks he's got the advantage and he's beating on you. When behind the scenes, the potter is still working the wheel. He don't even know it. But if he can get the person to jump off the wheel, you're screwed. Running 100% of the time usually gets you in big trouble. Ecclesiastes chapter 7 says, consider the work of the Lord. It says, he can make it straight when it's crooked. Amen. Everybody believes that. But here's what the people don't believe. And nobody ever knew this. Check this out. Here's a shocking revelation from God's word. In the day of prosperity, be joyful, because guess what? What you're looking for, I'll just speak for you. What you're looking for is your purpose in life, so to speak, your destiny, your call, whatever term you want to use. Maybe there's another term. That's up here. There. How do you get there? Well, God's got to give you a bunch of ups. But he also has to give you That's bad news. No, it's not. Without going through this, you can't get there. Each level requires more faith, more anointing, more skills, more experience, more training. You can't get that by getting dessert all the time. You got to stay on the wheel, and some of these chunks got to be cut out of there. Who likes surgery? Nobody. Spiritual surgery, yes, it's painful. Oh, it bears much fruit. And Father, how he loves it. He likes fruit because he's addicted to it. And he purges you so you can bear more fruit. God makes your crooked paths straight, but he also does what? He sends adversity for what? What purpose? Here it is. He has sent one against the other. So the person will learn he's not the potter. Brother Mike, I can't believe this. It just seems like every time things are going good for me, then they go bad. Stay on the wheel. You're right where you need to be. You can't have one without the other. You can't have the blessings without the adversity. Because you will never grow. You won't grow. Why? Human beings by nature, they're lazy. They get fat bottoms. They want to sit. Father's got to. Let's go. Oh, that's good. I'd rather just be a 2-ounce cup. Oh, wait a minute. No, I had you a 50-gallon vase in mind for you. Oh, you know, I'm kind of... No, it's time for some more discipline for you. Why? Because you're one of these non-cooperative Christians. You like to tell the Lord what to do. That's because you're so smart. Oh, you're a genius. Ask your friends. They'll verify it. You're super smart. But don't ask them when they're not around. They think you're an idiot. God's got to prod you just a little further. If you stay on that wheel, you're not a teacup, baby. You're a 50-gallon vase. What's the problem there? We can't see it while we're getting trimmed down here. That's when your faith and your trust carries you all the way home. Psalm 32 says, I will instruct you and teach you in the way that you will go if you stay on the wheel. Branches that fall off the vine. Don't be what? Don't be like a mule that has no understanding. Oh. You ever met muley Christians? Wow. I see them all the time. There's a certain art to working with mule Christians. Got to be tiptoe your way in to their hidden stuff in their closets and their soul. Got to be gentle sometimes. If you rush in there, they'll run out the door. Proverbs 26 is a solid scripture, isn't it? You take a whip for a horse and a bridle for the ass and a rod for the fool's back. Okay? What's this mean here? Discipline and training for foolish horses' asses. Just put it all together and stay on that wheel. Father's building a masterpiece. You jump off here. What was that? Have you ever seen those? You ever eat Chinese food? I always order the tea. They bring it out in this pot. It's boiling, right? I like hot tea. And that's the good part. Then the depression comes in. They bring you your teacup. I'm not even joking. It's about that big. And the entire meal, I'm going this way. See? Stupid. See, are you a little teacup or are you a spectacular fuss Father has planned for you? Well, it depends on how long you stay on that wheel. Doesn't take long to whip up a teacup. Chinese buffet. Those are pretty easy to make. They don't bear much fruit, though. Actually, they're a pain in the... Can we have, they gotta refill it. Could I have a real cup, please? No, here's a little one. Thanks. Some of you, no offense, are kind of like horses that need a good whipping.
Yeah.
Don't raise your hands. Some of you are asses. You need a bridle to be led around. Because you got off the wheel. And Proverbs 10 says, as vinegar is to the teeth, so is smoke to the eyes, and so is a what? Wow. Christians that stay on the wheel, they'll tough something out, and you can trust them, even during some hard times. Christians that jump off the wheel, if they show up, they won't get the job finished. You ever hired a born-again Christian to do work on your house? Fix your car? Ever had one of those?
Yeah.
You haven't? Do yourself a favor. Find you a witch doctor next time you get the car fixed. Because Christians fix your car and fix your house. They want a little grace. I can't come over today. My daughter's sick. Heathens run right over there because they got caught. Pot, coke, and crack. They got to get over and buy some. They don't care about their kids. They want to get your car fixed. Born again Christian, not going to roof your house, are they? Yeah, I don't feel good today. Glory to God. Okay, well, come Tuesday. Rain's Monday. You never done that, haven't you? Hire a heathen. Sluggards. Oh, God. They're just, ugh. There's nothing worse than that, is there? Oh, they just drive you nuts. Yeah. They don't get anything done. They're Christians who don't bear any fruit because they jumped off the wheel because they wanted to handle it themselves and do their own lives and be their own boss. When they made that choice, they lost the anointing. They lost their destiny. They lost their lives. So they have to suffer through in misery and suffering and agony, fighting every inch of the way over every stupid little trial that comes their way. Carnal Christians are okay with stuff that's crooked. Listen, if you get too many blessings in life, that's bad. See, God set one against the other, and that produces growth. See, you can't just constantly have me blessings like they do at the mega churches. Every prayer is me, 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 me. Half their prayer should be, Lord, help me endure this thing and learn what I have to learn. Let me grow to my next level. This crooked path straight. Now I need some adversity. There's another one straight. Now I need some more. Some Christians just don't have it. These folks have decided to do some heavy exercising. They don't even bother to change their clothes. A lot of Christians are like that. Ah, praise the Lord. They don't even change their clothes. No, this guy's killing it. No, these people here got off the wheel, folks. They're off the wheel. You know why a lot of people backslide? The molding was going well. They were growing. Things got a little tough. And they said, wow, no. I'm going to go back into sin. Why? Because that's easy. Sinning is easy. Doing the right thing is hard. What's potter's wheels for anyway? Why does he use a potter's wheel? Well, let's see it. Jacob chapter 32. When Jacob was alone, he wrestled with a man. The Hebrew word is aish, which means a person, until the breaking of the day. And he could not prevail against him, so he touched the hollow of his thigh. And his thigh was out of joint, it says. And he kept wrestling with him. And he said, let me go, for the day is breaking. It's almost morning. He said, I'm not going to let you go unless you bless me. Now, most Christians would have done what? Boom. Oh, I'm done. Wow. Help them, Lord. I want you to get to the point, hopefully tonight, where instead of rolling over like a dead dog, you keep fighting through the hollow of your thigh. Like Jacob did. What's your name? Jacob, he said, right? No, you're not Jacob anymore, Israel. Why? You are a prince who has prevailed. He went from the deceiver to the prevailer. How do you do that? He stayed on the wheel. Pushed his way through. Matthew chapter 16 says, blessed are you, Simon Barjona. Flesh and blood did not tell you that I am the Messiah, the Son of the living God. Father told you that. Simon's bearing some fruit here. I say to you that you are Petros. You're a what? Stone. And upon this Petra, rock, I will build my church. The gates of hell shall not prevail against it. Peter, and you, 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 and you. Stones. Built upon the rock. These little stones here are not hay or stubble. No. Simon Bar-Jonah. What? Simon stands for hearing. Bar-Jonah means the son of Jonas. He went from that to a stone. Saul, which means the desired one or to be desired, went from Saul to Paul. Why? They stayed on the wheel. They stayed on that wheel. Saul went from this big, big shot to the most broken Christian that ever lived and the most powerful. You don't see the irony there? I think you do. Jacob went from the deceiver to the prince who prevails. Why? He didn't jump off the wheel. He stayed right there. Toughed it out. The devil wants to make you a coward. Why? Cowards quit.
That's correct.
If you get two cowards together in a boxing match, not much of a fight. Goes to a decision, usually a draw. You get a tough fighter in there and a coward, that fight don't last long. You get Ali and Frazier in there, and you've got a chilla and a thrilla in Manila. And nobody backs down. What's God looking to do for you? He wants to make you to the devil a thrilla and a chilla everywhere you go. Not some gutless, useless, carnal, lukewarm, megachurch, carnal, whipped Christian who runs off and jumps off the wheel every chance he gets. He's looking to turn you into a masterpiece. He did these? Why not you? Why not you? All right, let's go to our last section, shall we? Revelation chapter 2. Why is all this so important? Why was that important? Why is a potter wheel so important? Because it breeds overcomers. Amen. The wheel breeds overcomers. People that jump off the wheel always fail. Overcomers have a special place in the kingdom of God in eternity. Not just Christians in eternity. You didn't hear me. You lead somebody to Christ on their deathbed at the hospital. Have you ever done that? I've done it a couple times. It's an honor and a privilege. I couldn't have been happier. I went out of there doing cartwheels, and I can't even physically do cartwheels. But that person died shortly thereafter, and they have no great rewards in heaven. Why? Why? Obvious. It's obvious they had no Christian life. They didn't overcome anything. They didn't have a wheel to even stay on. But their souls were saved. Hey, all the angels are rejoicing. They can't believe it. They're so happy. I was happy. You were happy when you did it. Couldn't have gone any better. But you are not on your deathbed. You are in another league. Here's the league you want to be in. Not every Christian that goes to heaven goes there as an overcomer. That's what you want. That's what my daughter wants. Can't you hear her? She wants to be an overcomer. You get special privileges and glory if you are a Christian who overcomes. These are the ones who don't jump off the wheel in this life. What do you get? Oh, here are some of the benefits. Quite amazing here. Hidden manna, white stone, a new name that only you know about. Revelation chapter 2, he that overcomes and keeps my works to the end. Dude, jumping off the wheel is not the end. Translation, you screwed up. Let's fix it. Jump back on the wheel. Jump back on. What do you get if you're an overcomer? Not just a regular Christian. You get authority over nations. Most Christians have an asinine view of heaven. Here's what it is. We're all up there wearing winged outfits and we're flapping around. That's all crap. You are given a career, a life, a new life in glory. And that career directly corresponds to what you did here. And if you did nothing here, your career there is far less than his who did great things here. Well, I don't care, I just want to make it. I know, you're the one who jumped off the wheel. Anybody who just wants to make it has jumped off the wheel. They're mediocre in any field, Christian or not. And you've worked with them at work. You can't even believe they're getting a paycheck. Some of them suck so bad, they should be paying their employer. And you know who they are. Well, in the kingdom of God, we've got those losers too. We got the people that jumped off the wheel that couldn't take the heat, so they had to get out of the kitchen. Some Christians, only the overcomers, have authority over, wow, this is an incredible statement. And these are not my words, they got nothing to do with me, I'm just reading them. And they shall rule with a rod of iron. What's that mean? That's talking about ruling with authority. It's symbolic of authority. It doesn't mean literally beating people with iron. He's using figurative language here to describe powerful things in the other side, in the new world. And I will give them the morning star. That would be Christ himself. Check this out. Revelation 3, he that overcomes. Remember, he that overcomes assumes, by definition, the other ones don't overcome. There are some that don't overcome. There's some that do overcome. Otherwise, he would have said, everyone that goes to heaven is an overcomer. That is not true. Being born again and dying and going to heaven is different from being a born-again Christian who overcomes. By definition, if you overcame something, you had something to overcome. Guess what happens to overcomers? Their names are not blotted out of the book of life. Their names are confessed before Father and his angels, whoever they are. It says it right here. He that overcomes are pillars in the temple of God in glory. What's that? I don't know, but it sounds great. And they don't leave anymore. Translation, you've arrived in glory. I like that. What else? You're kidding me. I get a new name of God written, and the name of the New Jerusalem is mine for overcomers. I get a new, God's new name written on me. Wow. Talk about some tattoos. That's
glory tattoos. For only for overcomers. Not Christians. Not just Christians that are punks. No. Revelation 3, he that overcomes will what? Sit with me, Jesus said, in my throne. Not all the Christians, the overcoming ones. Translation, the ones that didn't jump off the wheel. Why'd they jump off the wheel? Because this kind of hurts. You're trimming stuff off, you're making indentations, you're expanding stuff, you're pulling stuff, you're spinning it. Not a fun afternoon at times. I admit it. I'm with you on that. Don't jump off the wheel. Because he's building an incredible masterpiece. You is it. They will overcome as I overcame. As that proves there are different levels of Christians in glory. Don't tell me they aren't. It says it right there. Well, if you do nothing, you go to heaven, you're an overcomer. Really? Was Christ? Was he a do-nothing Christian? What? That's ridiculous. And what's the last thing he told you? The Holy Ghost is telling you all this. You better listen. Christians! These aren't heathens. This is you. You stay on the wheel. You tough this thing out to the next level. And then the crooked paths go straight. Then the adversity comes in again. Then the crooked paths get straighter again. Folding. Ooh, look at how big he is now. Wigglesworth started out as a Chinese buffet teacup. Here was Wigglesworth. 40 years later, he's a monster. Take them. Every one of them, every powerful Holy Ghost preacher, male or female, had one thing in common. They had one thing we don't have. What is it? They stayed on the wheel. What you gonna get if you stay on that wheel? Well, let's go over it again. Let's have a review. If you stay on the wheel and you don't jump off and you don't give up and you don't run in fear, and you tough this thing out, yeah, you will face adversity. You have to, because God set one against the other. He sent the blessings against the trials. He sent the crooked places against the smooth walkways. He sets one against the other to get the person to grow to the next level. Because Father is the husbandman, and he prunes the branches. And the branches who jump off the wheel, they wither out and they are gathered up over yonder. Never forget this, please. Please, if you stay a sinner or you become a saint, you can never just stay right there. The devil will never let you stay just a sinner. He'll make you a worse sinner. He'll push you to be worse and worse and worse and worse and worse. Yeah. He's not going to let you just have one ugly divorce. No. He's got a trail of them lined up behind you. Bunch of rotten men and women coming your way. If you become a Christian, you cannot just stay right there. It's impossible. Father won't let you just stay there. The devil won't let you stay there. This is a war. You can't get off the hook lightly. I'm sorry. There's no other way. Your life will either continue to deteriorate or you will fight your way up to your destiny and your call from God. You cannot just stay here. I quit. No, there's no quitting with the devil. He don't quit. What else do you get? New names. Oh, my name is Mike Smith. Can you imagine that? That's the most common and probably most useless name in the United States. Mike Smith. Have you ever met a Mike Smith? Everybody has. They're all over the place. They're like hemorrhoids. They're everywhere. When I read this section of text, I practically memorized it. I can't wait to get rid of my name and get a new name written down in glory. I can't wait. I can't wait. Some people have great names. George Bush. Barack Obama. Mike Smith. That sucks. I want a new name from the Lord. That's what I want. But to do that, by God's grace, I must stay on that wheel. I must take the carving. I got to get the shaping. I got to take the crooked trails. Then I travel down the smooth ones. Then I take another crooked one. I got to stay on that wheel. I got to hold on. I got to hang in there. By God's grace, to get my new name and get rid of my old name, which I'm planning to do. Here's a name I'll take in a heartbeat. Man, I want my name left in that book. I don't want it taken out. How about you? Here, here, indeed. I want to take a shot at sitting there someday and looking around. I don't know what that's like, but I'll get up there and look around. I sure will. How about you? Yeah, we'll get there. Don't get off that wheel. Don't do it. Don't do it. Well, it's not fun. Listen, there's a lot of things in the spirit world that aren't fun, okay? And serving the devil ain't fun either, okay? You like a little depression, do you? How about some addictions? How about a few divorces? You like that? Oh, how about some sicknesses? You like clinical depression? You like some illnesses? Oh, that stuff's not fun either. The devil's got a lot of things for you that he'll mix in with some fun. Yeah, drugs and food and sex. And he'll give you lots of fun, and then he'll mix in his little blessings with it. Yeah, on this Holy Ghost side, yeah, there's some trimming that has to be done. There's some crappy rocks in that thing that got to be dug out of there and pulled out. Yeah, there's some spiritual surgery going on. The vase is getting better. It's looking prettier. It gets to this point, then the colors start coming in. You jump off the wheel, you lose forever. You will never fulfill your destiny. Never. Stay on that wheel. Thank you, Lord. That's the end of the Bible study tonight. Father, during our prayer service tonight, several people are going to come up because I can see them, several of them right now. They've jumped off the wheel. They have jumped off the wheel. They've been doing stuff on their own. They've been handling their own life. They've been their own boss.
And they are going to repent tonight. They're going to repent and they're going to get back on that wheel. They're going to back on that wheel because the light has dawned on them. A light has dawned on them. When you jump off that wheel, when you land down there, the devil is waiting for you. And what you thought was hard at the time, before you jumped, actually, you'd give anything to be back there. Because the devil, he doesn't discipline people. He doesn't train them. He beats them into submission. He physically, verbally, spiritually, and emotionally abuses people. Father, gently, lovingly, with conviction, not condemnation, trains us, Lord. You're training us. You're disciplining us. You're showing us. You're illustrating. You're helping us gently. And that's what we really needed all along. And so right now, tonight, several people are going to get back on that wheel. They're going to do it tonight, and we're going to pray our guts up for them, and the Holy Ghost is going to put them right back on the wheel and restore them ASAP. In Jesus' mighty name. Amen. Gracias. We're going to take a 5 minute.
Thanks, sir.
Bless you. We're going to take a 5 minute break here. And, oh, wait a minute, on second thought. Who wants to take a 5 minute break? Raise your hand. Two people. That's it. Okay. Let's close our eyes in. If you need to leave right now, you're dismissed. I'll give you about 60 seconds. You need to go right now. Just go ahead and leave. Go ahead and leave. Ministry team, can you double time it then and grab your badges and come on up quickly? Their people are ready to go to prayer right now. So I won't take a break since they're ready to go. Quickly. If you need to leave, God bless you. Thank you for coming. The offering bucket and the books and everything are in the back on the left. God love you. Thank you for your kindness and your prayers and your donations. Just take a minute here, then we're going to go. Some of you have jumped off that wheel. Some of you jumped off that wheel, and you are going to get back on it tonight. You went back to your old life, and that was hideous. You made a tragic mistake. By jumping off that wheel, you should have stayed there and let Father mold you and make you and break you if he had to, mend you, whatever he had to do. You should have stayed, and you didn't. You didn't. Jumped off that wheel. You're going to get put right back on it tonight. Right back on there. When you jumped off the wheel, you lost your healing. You lost your... How you doing?
I love you.
Love you too.
I'm glad I met you. I'm going to jump back on the wheel.
Well, good.
Thanks to you.
Thank you. Thank you.
And I'll be back.
Okay, you will. Okay, thank you for coming tonight. Some of you jumped off that wheel, and you're going to jump back on it tonight. And when you jumped off there, you lost your healing, you lost your deliverance, your finances went bust, your relationships blew up, everything went to hell in a handbasket. You took a jump, and you looked back on it, and you said, hey, I should never have done that. I should have just stayed on the wheel. I should have toughed it out. I should have trusted. I should have kept on believing. I know Father would have come through for me. I just know it. It would have happened. You jumped off that wheel. You raise your hand quickly. One. Okay, come up here, sweetheart. Come on up here, sir. Come on up here. You jumped off the wheel. Things got tough. I know. It happens to so many people. There's nothing to be ashamed of. All you have to do is repent right now. Come right on up here. We're going to pray with you. Come on up here. You jumped off the wheel. You jumped off. You shouldn't have done it. Come up here quickly. You jumped off that wheel. We're going to pray for you first. We're going to pray for you first.
Mike, this pray is for Shirley. You. Okay.
Shirley, this is. Hi, sweetheart.
Hey, how are you?
You need prayer?
Yeah.
You stay here, okay? Don't leave. All right. Okay. You jumped off that wheel. Hey, Tony, can you bring me that hand mic for a second? Thank you. Streamers, you just stay right in front of your computer there. You jumped off the wheel and you're going to come back tonight. Maybe you're a full-blown backslider and you've been screwing around with your life. Thank you. You've been screwing around with your life and now Rick's going to lead us in a prayer here. Hey, do you mind praying for me a second? I got to take Tracy a bathroom.
Oh, okay. You know, I think you got to be a little bold. You got to fight through that. I know the devil blocked me from many altar calls telling me, you know what, you just pray that prayer you want to pray right there in that seat. But you got to force yourself to do something that in the natural, it doesn't make sense. In the natural, you can say, I can pray right there in my seat. I'll just get everything the Lord has for me. He knows my heart. But if you look through Scripture, it's always faith. It's the faith that pleased the Lord. It's the faith that got God to move. That's why it's so important to stretch yourself. And you're going to change your life. You're going to do something for the kingdom of God. You're going to do something different that you didn't do before. Well, that's going to require you to step out of your comfort zone and drop that fear. Well, I'm with my friend. I don't know what he'll think of me if it sounds like I jumped off the wheel. And you got all night. You might have to struggle for 10 minutes, but we'll keep this altar open till the last person gets the chance to come up here. Now, everybody that's you're turning your life over, just begin to open up your heart now. Don't come up here like coming up here is the magical thing to happen. You're coming up here to tell the Lord you're sorry. You're coming up here to make peace with the Lord. Allow your sins now to be covered in the shed blood of Jesus Christ. Lord, I'm so sorry. Lord, I didn't know that my position in eternity was at stake. My position in eternity was worth fighting for. Lord God, I gambled my salvation. I could have been drawn into hell if it wasn't for your grace and for your mercy, Lord. Your kindness upon me, Lord. Lord Jesus, I want to be delivered, Lord. I want to be set free, Lord. I picked up some spirits. I picked up some bad attitudes. I picked up some negative emotions, Lord. My peace is drained out. Now my joy is gone. I find comfort in evil, Lord. I'm so sorry. I turn my heart over to you, Jesus. Have mercy upon me, Lord. I've done things that are wrong again and again, Lord. I did not listen to you, Lord. And I want to be delivered, Lord. I had a small vision of myself, Lord. Barely making it as a Christian, barely being somebody significant for the kingdom of God, Lord. And I read your word where you take nobodies and nothings and you do everything you want to do through them, Lord. And I shoveled those off to the side. Now is time to turn. Turn against these devils. You have to realize you got to get out of that religious jargon. Told you it was all about the indwelling sin. Yeah, they work the indwelling sin, right? To walk right into you as the spiritual house. Walked right in and brought this chaos. Now you're going to have to use a little bit of tenacity and a little bit of fight to get these spirits out because they've been bullying you. They've been punking you for days and years and decades. You're going to have to command them to leave. They'll resist you. But it says, if you resist the devil, then he will flee from you. Devil, I bind your power right now in the name of Jesus Christ. I hate you, devil. I hate what you do. I hate what you've done to my family and taken people to hell. I resist you in the name of Jesus Christ. I hate lukewarmness. I hate backsliding in the mighty name of Jesus. I loose your holds in the name of Jesus. I bind all of your power and I drive you out now according to Jesus Christ, the Son of God. Come out, devil. Come out of there in the name of Jesus, the Son of God. Come out of there, devil. Come out of there, devil. Come out of there, devil. Come out of there in the name of Jesus. I'm not going to sit back and act like you didn't do nothing to me, devil. I rebuke you in the name of Jesus. I command you to come out of me in the name of Jesus. I command you to come out of my bones and my body and my mind. Come out, devil. Come out of there. Come out of there and I'll fight him, sir. Come out of me in the name of Jesus. I'm not going to be a broke Christian. I'm not going to be a broke Christian. I'm not going to be a broke Christian. Come out in the name of Jesus. Fight him in your mind, sir. Come out, devil. Fight him in your mind. Come out. Come out. Come out. Come out, devil. I'm not going to take it anymore. Not this. No. I'm not listening to your voice anymore of complacency. I'm not finding this worldly amusement entertaining another day, devil. Not when my soul's at stake. Not when my ministry's at stake. Come out. Come out. Devil, let this man go now. You foul devil. You robbed the child of God. He's been called by name. He's been washed in the blood. Now, devil, we loose your hold. Come out. We loose your hold now. Come out of there. Satan, I command you to come out of there. Fear of being a powerful man of God. Come out. Fear of not living as you die. Fear of not having the peace of God, the prosperity that comes with it. Come out. Take a big breath.
Right now. Right now. Get out. Get out. Get out. Let's go. Let's go.
Take over. What's going on here?
I don't know what's going on. Okay, and then I started my business. I started.
How did it get scrambled?
I don't know. I thought I was doing it with my ex boyfriend.
Your ex boyfriend?
I met him.
What was his name?
Started a business.
What was his name?
Hakeem Rahimi.
What?
Hakeem Rahimi.
Hakeem? What was you left him? Was he mad about it? Did he put a curse on you or say bad things about you?
I believe so.
Okay, raise your hands. Lord Jesus, she dated a man named Hakeem. She should never even have shaken hands with him. She was out of your will. She shouldn't have done it. Now he put a curse on her and things have gone bad. And she's going to repent right this second. You going to repent tonight? You repenting tonight?
Yes.
Ah, good. Go. Go ahead. Go ahead. I'm going to repent right now of dating Hakeem. I should have never been intimate with him. Should have never been dating him. That was wrong. And some of his spirits entered me. And now I've got a curse on my life and everything's going bad. And I'm going to repent of it right this second. Hakeem, in the name of Jesus, you come out of her right now. She repents of that relationship. She repents of dating him. She repents right now in Jesus' holy name. I'll repent of it right this second. Spirit of lust and anger from Hakeem, leave me now. Come out of my body now. Come out of my body right now. Come out. I repent. I got off the wheel. I dated a man I should have never dated. Now repent of it right this second. Right this second. Did he tell you? Did he tell you? Did he tell you what it was? What's blocking the healing? What? Okay. What?
I'm thinking that with the healing it will come because.
You come out here, you're coming out right now.
Let me tell you this story. I had a friend in Jerusalem. I built the model of Jerusalem, an old model of Jerusalem, which is in this place since 1995. While I was building this model, two believers, they were coming to visit me. One of them stopped coming. So I told him, what happened?
You get out.
I don't know. I said, no. He said, he have gangrene in his feet. And the doctor is going to amputate his feet. And he said, no. He said, God will heal me. So he resisted the doctor, have a fight with the doctor. I said, I want to come to your house to visit him. He said, no, you can't. I said, I will. He said, no, you can't from the smell. He said, it doesn't matter. I'm going to come. It's very stinky when you go inside. It's leg the whole day. Nylon bag and swelling.
She dated some guy who was chock full of demons. That woman there.
Six months later, I saw him walking outside the museum. I said, what happened?
This is it.
He had a stick in his hand.
No more, you torment.
But he was walking normally.
Okay. What's that got to do with your ears?
I'm thinking about my case, this case, which I have been to 20 doctors. I have a file, I'll show you.
Yeah.
It could be healed like that.
What's that got to do with your healing?
The ringing. I have terrible ringing.
What does that story have to do with that hearing? Your ringing.
It's faith. It's the same thing.
It's what?
With faith, it's going to heal.
Okay, see, that's not true. So that must be part of our problem. You're believing some kind of lie. Now, something's blocking your healing. You have faith, but a lot of people have faith and they're not healed. Correct?
Right now.
Correct?
Yeah.
You don't know that?
No, that's right.
Come
right
out. Now. Correct? Okay, so that means something's blocking you. And so that's what I was asking the Lord to show you. You've got faith, but something's blocking
right
your healing.
Right now.
So just ask him real quick. Come on. Lord Jesus, what is blocking my healing? There it comes. Keep coughing. There he comes. He's coming out right now. Keep coughing. Come out. Come out of there right now. Come out. That's the demon coming out. Come out of his ears right now. Go. Come out right now. Come out. Come out. Go. Blocker, come out. Blocker, come out right now. Quickly. Come out of there. Hey, what do you need?
I've backslided for about 6 years. I'm on the mend slowly, but I just want more of the Spirit's presence in my life.
Yeah, why'd you backslide?
University got caught up.
What?
University got caught up with rock and roll and girls.
Why'd you do that? Go. Come on. Why you chose that over the Lord? What triggered that?
I wasn't waiting for him. I jumped off the wheel, like you mentioned.
Yeah, but you did it for a reason. What was the reason you jumped?
Impatience. I wanted to do my own thing.
Why?
You
didn't trust him?
I didn't trust him. I wanted to do my own thing.
Okay, now we got it. Okay, there you go. Come on, now just repent. Lord God, in the name of Jesus, I repent of being impatient, arrogant, egotistical, self-willed, doing my own thing. Come on, pray harder. Pray hard. Come out. Stop it. Stop. Satan, come out. Who needs to be healed? Come up here quickly. See my hands waving? Come up here right now. So you can be healed. Need to be healed? Come up right now.
She has cancer. We prayed for her. She threw up a bunch. She has cancer. Breast cancer. It's
now,
like.
Now, who did you used to hate? Who did you used to hate when you were younger? Your mother. Did you know that brought a curse on? Who's that guy? Who are you? Who's that guy? What?
Husband.
That's your husband. This is your wife?
Yeah.
Okay. Now, when you were young, you hated your mother. Did you know the Bible says that brought a curse on you? Did you know that? Did you know that? Did you feel that? That's where the curse is. What was your mother's name? June?
Sue.
Sue, okay, ready? Go. Lord Jesus, forgive me for what I've done to my mother. Forgive me for hating my mother. God, have mercy upon me. I want this curse broke off of me right now in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. And I want these cancer demons and this poisonous slime out of my body right now. And I want this curse broke off my chest and my heart right this second. Forgive me, dear Lord. Come on, pray harder, sweetheart. Pray harder. What's her name?
Rachel,
pray harder, honey. Come on now. I'm sorry I hated my mother. That brought a curse on me. I'm sorry I hated my mother. Come up here if you need to be healed. Right now, quickly. Mother, help me. God, forgive me for hating my mother. That brought a curse on me. Now I got cancer. Holy Spirit, save me right now. Holy Ghost, save me right now. Sweet Jesus. Sweet Jesus. Sweet Jesus, is your mother still alive?
Yes, I speak to her every day.
All right, you do? You get along good with her now?
Absolutely.
Okay, Lord, this was an old curse. How old were you when you hated her?
Like 8 or 9.
And why'd you hate her?
Because she beat me.
She beat you. Okay, Lord, her mother beat her. And that spirit of hate got into her soul when she was young. And that's where that curse came in. It took years to develop this cancer, but tonight we're going to break its hold by totally releasing her mother from her soul. Right now. Right now. Mother, go. Right now. Fear. Childhood fear. Fear of death. Fear of dying. Fear of pain. Come out of me right now in Jesus' mighty name. Come out of me right now in the name of Jesus Christ. You filthy cancer spirit of mine, come out of there right now. There it comes. There it comes. There it comes. There it goes. The cancer demon's coming up. Go! Here he comes. There he is. Come out, cancer. Cancer, I command you to die. I curse you to death, cancer. Die. Come out of that woman of God. Come out of the woman of God. Go now in Jesus' mighty name. There it goes. Cancer healed. What happened? What?
Nothing till now.
Nothing happened? Okay. What's blocking it? Do you know? Do you know what when it came on?
When it came on?
When did it happen?
A couple years ago.
Did you pray hard? Huh? You did? You speak in tongues?
No, I don't.
Okay, hold on. When did it happen?
2 years ago.
2 years ago. Now, just before that, did anything odd happen to you?
A couple years ago. It came slowly, slowly it came.
So just before 2 years ago, did something strange or odd happen to you?
No, it happened a couple years ago, so I'm...
No, before that, I said. Before 2 years ago. Did something odd or unusual happen to you? Did you get sick? Did you have a car wreck? Did you lose your job? Did anything unusual happen before 2 years ago? Before 2 years ago. Did you have a fight with someone? Did somebody put a curse on you? Did you lose your job?
I'm sure there is curse. I'm sure there is.
Who did it?
I'm sure there is.
Who did it?
Because, you see, in Jerusalem, my uncle was a patriarch of Jerusalem, a big shot, American VIP.
Yeah.
And I was helping him because he was doing renovation in the church. And I was catching whatever was happening there. So the people, the mafia guys, they didn't like what I did because I was...
The mafia
working.
Guys?
Well, yeah, because I was working for the church.
Oh.
And those people were robbing the church.
Okay, so let's try that. Raise your hands. Lord God, I pray for every one of those... Come out of that body. Keep coughing. Come out. Come out. Come out of there. Come out. Keep coughing. Go. Come out of that body right now. Lord God, I pray for every one of those mafia guys. I pray for them right now, and I bless them in Jesus' name. I ask you to forgive them and help them. I pray for my uncle right now. Go ahead. Pray out loud. Okay. I just pray after me. Burra baba. Kelo sata. Voto shete. Meo shava. Bola Baba. Kenosina. Vakaba. You notice how easy you were repeating that? You notice that? Nothing to it. Now, that's the Greek word glossa. I was praying in glossa.
Yeah.
But I was praying in short syllables. Short syllables.
She doesn't want
you. Notice that?
Yeah.
She doesn't want
you. Burabba. Three syllables. Yeah?
Yep.
Now, this time you do it again, only you add some syllables on your own. And just relax and let it flow. You already have it in your spirit, man. Just haven't released it.
Okay.
Every born-again Christian has it.
I grew up in a church that didn't believe.
Yeah, that's why it blocks it. Usually it's bad teaching that blocks it, like a cork in a bottle. It blocks it.
Yeah.
I see it all the time. Thousands of times I see it.
I watch a lot of your videos on YouTube, and thank God for your ministry.
Oh, thank you. Now you just relax, and take a big breath, and just pray. Ready? Burra baba. Mesho baba shite. Bola barra moshondoro boba. Ero raba shandara vashi de la bo. Undoro mosha barra vashi de re baba. Yelo la mosha barra vashi de re burra ba. I pray for all those people that cursed me. Everybody who cursed me, everybody who said negative things about me, I bless them and I pray for them and I break this curse off of me now. I break this curse off my body right now. I command the demon of sin to leave my body right now. I command this sinful Christian life I've been leading to leave me now. In Jesus' holy name. I command unbelief and doubt to go now. I command my family's evil spirits to come out of me right now. Go now. Come out now. Come out now. Come out now. Negative emotions, frustrations, anger, demons from my husband, go. Get out of my head right now. Unbelief and doubt, come out of my body right now. Lust and pornography, go.
Get out of here.
Get out of my body right now.
Get out of my body right now.
I break this curse off me now. Come out in Jesus' mighty name. He's got some curse from Jerusalem. How'd that go?
It went okay.
Okay, now, just relax and pray harder. Like, pray, push, pray. Bromo shavashate. Yeko la mashavadu. Uremo shade. Good. Jerusalem, curse you. Break off of me right now. Evil, come out of that body right now. What's wrong with her?
Guilt.
She got what?
Guilt one.
What? Guilt from what?
Her son committing suicide 20 years ago.
Oh, the son. That's easy to fix. I'll be right back.
It's not my burden to carry.
Get out of that body right now. What's wrong with you? What are you up here for?
Very dysfunctional family. I got ADD and back problems.
From a childhood?
My back problems from when I was a young man. ADD from a childhood.
Right, and then about where'd the stress come in your family?
What's
stress?
That?
The stress.
Right now, there's so
when
much
you were young.
I never felt good about myself. My mom was a single mother. I remember
and your dad,
from an early age having sexual thoughts that I didn't even know about.
Did you have perverts in your family tree? Come out of there right now.
Maybe.
Go now.
Not that I know.
Go now. Go now. Go now. What's wrong with him now?
The doctor said his liver functions are four times.
His liver functions
are four times the normal.
Oh. Come on up here. Yeah. If he doesn't change and repent, we already went over this. He's going to die. He's going to die if he doesn't change. Now they're going after his liver. Huh?
He's making a lot of effort.
Oh, okay, good. There we go. That's our only hope.
That's only because he's going to tear him down to nothing.
The doctor said in the past that he had fat liver, the same fat liver that I got, that I got cirrhosis in my past. I got cirrhosis, but God healed me from cirrhosis to me several years ago. But they say that he had fat liver, and now the liver functions are from 40 to 160.
You come up and out, so up and out of the womb right now. Up and out of the womb right now.
We got major changes. We need major changes. That's the only hope we've got. See, his condition's different from yours. He is not you. He's different. He's different. He's different.
See?
Yeah. Lord, he needs a massive heart change. A change of heart. All negative feelings about God and being angry at God and frustrated with God have to come out of there before his liver falls out on the floor. And I'm praying right now, any negative feelings, any negative thoughts for God will now leave tonight once and for all. Right now. We'll leave now. All of it. All bad thoughts about God. All frustrations about God. All anger to him.
I have the reason why I feel about towards God this way is because I look at things logically, and the way I see it, I see it as God as evil. I don't hate God, but the way I see it, so I am willing to just let go of everything and not look. I'm thinking in my mind, and if I look at it logically, to me God is not good.
Yeah, see what I mean?
But I am willing to let go of that. If that's my only hope, I'm willing to just follow God and just it doesn't matter what I think, just follow him blindly. If that's what it takes, I will do it. But I'm just saying that's what I'm coming from.
Yeah, I hear what you just said. Neither of those things are gonna work for us. That's not gonna work. So we're stuck again. You can't follow God blindly. That won't work. That's not going to work, what he said. And then what he said about these bad things about God, what he's really saying is that God's really like that, but I'd just be willing to overlook it and go blindly follow God. That won't work. He believes a giant stack of lies. What he believes is a lie. Yeah. It's not true.
So what?
God is not like what he thinks. It's all lies.
Let her go. Come out right now.
Do you know what a lie is? A lie is something that's not true. So what he said about God is all lies put in his mind by the devil, who is the father of lies. So his step is he has to renounce and reject all those lies and then replace it with truth. Not just follow God blindly. That won't do any good.
So the logical thinking,
boom, it's killing us. Because human logic doesn't work. It's God's word. God's word is the only truth. When God told him that I love you unconditionally, he didn't believe him. Okay? He has to repent of that. When the devil told him God is evil, that's a lie. He needs to repent of that. God is not evil. The devil's evil. Lies bring sickness and death. Now they're ruining his liver. Oh, no. All of it. Repent of all of it. It's all lies. He's trying to figure it out. God's word says that, and that's true. God's word is true.
What is my step? Reject those lies?
Yep. And receive truth. Truth.
And believe it. That's my
faith. The truth by faith. You believe it by faith because it is truth.
Help us, Lord.
Logic's going to, that'll kill all of us. I used to do that. I never got anywhere with God. Human logic is nothing but stupidity. You can't figure it out. You can't figure it out. It won't work. He's thinking about how to figure this out. It's not going to work. It needs to stop tonight before something else happens. After the liver, what's next? What will the demons do next? I'm asking. What's the next thing to fall apart? I don't know. I'm asking you. But whatever it is, if he doesn't change, the next thing is coming. Repent of listening to lies. God is bad. God's evil. God, this, that, all, it's all lies.
For example, he said that it's unfair that good people who do good things are in the hell.
Logic.
Yeah, so he says it's not
all lies. Not fair. Logic, not
fair.
All lies. All lies.
You need to believe just what it is in the
Bible. Bible. Now, listen, let's go back in time real quick, okay? I know what's wrong with you. Come out. Come out. You've got a spirit of rejection in there. And he jumped in there when you were little. Come out. And then he got in the driver's seat and took it the rest of the way. And all the crap you're facing now started out there, back there, okay?
That lady you prayed for, she had a lump. It's gone.
Well, I whacked her right on it. It's gone. You're kidding. Glory. Now, what you got to do is go back there and get him.
How do I do that?
I'll show you.
All right.
Raise your hands. Lord Jesus, Son of God.
Lord Jesus, Son of God.
A rejection spirit took me when I was little.
Holy Ghost right now. Holy Ghost right now.
God, I want this rejection demon from my dad, my mom, my childhood. I want it out now in the name of the Lord. Now you spirit of rejection, I forgive everybody that ever hurt me. Come out. I forgive everybody who said anything bad about me. And most of all, I have to forgive myself. In the name of Jesus Christ, go. I repent of hating and criticizing and nagging myself. Go. Come out. Come out. Come out. Come out. Come out. Spirit of rejection, you come out of this man now. What's your dad's name?
I don't know. I don't know who my dad is.
Whoever his dad was, whatever his spirits were, come out of your son right now. Come out of your son right now. Go. Come out. Here they come. Cough again. Come out. Here he comes. Cough again. Come out. Right now. Come out. He's got a rejection demon from his dad. He never knew it. Come out. Keep coughing. Come out right now. Keep coughing. Come out right now. Come out right now. Come out right now. What happened? Is it gone?
I had a lump right here.
Is it gone? Yeah, I know. There was a curse there. When I whacked you, it disappeared. Thank you, Jesus. Turn around. Lead the praise. Let me have your hand. Give me that. Hold that. Put your hand up. Put your hand up. Just do what I tell you. Raise your hands. I've done this before. Raise your hands. Thank you, Jesus. Come on, we're going to get the fear demon out of there next.
Yes.
He's next.
Yes.
Come on. Thank you, Jesus. Just do what I tell you. I know my business. Do what I tell you. Thank you, Jesus. Atta girl. Come on. Let your praise go. Make her. Force her to do it. Force her to thank you, Jesus. Come on, let your praise go. What's wrong with this girl? Hi.
This is Sherry. This is Mike. Viv prayed for her before.
What's wrong with you, honey?
I had a tumor in this year, and the doctor botched it up. And all I hear is like an ocean wave all day.
Oh, what's the name of that doctor?
Rizzio.
Rizzio?
Uh-huh.
Now, something else. You were verbally abused by who? Who trashed you years ago? Verbally abused, talking down to you. Your dad. What's his name?
Keith.
Raise your hands. Father God, close your eyes. Keith. Father, I had bad feelings about my dad, and it brought a curse on me. Years ago, he hurt me. He said negative things about me. He made me develop low self-esteem, low self-concept. Father God, I repent of it right now, and I release my dad, and I release Dr. Rizzo. I release him right now. Go now. Go now. Come out. Dr. Rizzo, come out of that body. Right now.
Glory, Jesus.
What's going on here? What you need, honey?
I've just been praying for deliverance.
From what?
Just have intimacy issues with my husband. No, that's not the abuse.
Now, before, how long have you been married?
11 years.
And then before that, did you have intimacy problems with people?
I had double sexual abuse.
And what age?
At 13.
Who did it?
A guy named David.
David, okay. Now, David's spirit, was it fondling or intercourse?
Both.
Yeah. Okay. That man's spirit entered your body. It was a fear spirit. A fear spirit that is currently now ruining your marriage. Now close your eyes. Let's go back. What's his name again? The abuser.
David.
David. Father God, if David is alive right now we go and ask you, Lord, to go hunt David down. Ask you to hunt him down in the name of Jesus. And put your hands on him and forgive him. David, you pervert. You be forgiven in Jesus' mighty name. And we release you now from her soul. Take a big breath. Blow. We release you, David, and your sexual perversion demons. We release you right now from her womb. Right now, you come out of that womb, David. Take a breath and blow. David, come out, you pervert. You're trying to ruin my marriage. You've ruined my intimacy. You come out right now in Jesus' mighty name. Oh, you ready? Now let's get that fear demon out of there. You ready? Can you hear me? All right, you got also got a fear spirit in there. That fear spirit, if we don't get it out, he'll let the cancer demon back in later. You follow me? All right. Lord Jesus, I repent of being afraid and not trusting your word. I repent. I repent of it right now.
Yes.
Being afraid and not trusting your word. I do trust your word. I thank you for removing that spirit in my chest and that curse from my family when I was young. And I want this evil spirit of fear out of my body. In the mighty name of Jesus, the Son of God. Spirit of fear, you come out. You come out now. I renounce you in Jesus' holy name. And I command you to leave my body right now. I command you to get out of my body right now. By the authority of the word of God. Then you come out now. There he comes. There he comes. There he comes. Come out of that body right now. Here he comes. There he is. There he is. Come out. Go. Go in Jesus' mighty name. Go now. Tell him to go. Go in Jesus' mighty name. Demon of fear, come out of my wife. Demon of fear, come out of my wife. Come out right now. Come out right now. Right now. There it goes. There it goes. Be healed. I command my husband's spirits to leave me as well. Every one of them. Fear of intimacy. Demon of fear, you come out too. Come out of there. Right now. Come out. Come out. Go now. Come out now. Come out right now. Go now. You get out of my body right this second. I break this curse off me right now. One, two, three. Break. There it went. Did you see that? It shot out of your face.
Oh. Everything in God, in God's hand, but you know what? I'm having insomnia now, and I'm feeling that I'm forgetting things, like losing my memory sometimes. And
yeah, the whole family's getting wiped out. This whole family's getting wiped out. Demons are taking the whole family. Somebody's got to turn this thing around. Anybody? How about you? Would you do it? Would you turn this family around and fight against these devils?
I'll try.
You would? Yeah, great. Well, let's try him then. Maybe he'll do something. In the name of Jesus Christ, Satan, I bind your power. Let my family go right now. Say that. I bind you right now in the name of Jesus. Say that. I command you to let my family go. My whole family's going to hell in a handbasket, and I'm not going to stand here and watch it. Full of unbelief and doubt and low self-esteem and negative emotion. I rebuke it in the name of Jesus. I rebuke this sin in this family. I rebuke this sin in Jesus' holy name. Right now. How'd that go? How'd it go? That curse lift off you?
But maybe we need to have a private session or something.
Okay. Call me tonight. Yeah. Okay. How'd it go?
I don't know.
Did it come out?
I feel stuff coming up in my chest and stuff a little bit.
Did it leave?
I don't know if it left or not. Okay. How you tell?
Now, well, you can sense a relief when the demon comes out. Now, you've got doubt and unbelief in your head, so let's pray about that first. Father, in the name of Jesus, I rebuke this doubt in my mind and this unbelief in my heart. I come against it in the name of the Lord, and I command this wickedness from my childhood, my adulthood, to leave me. I want this stuff out. Satan, loose my mother right now. Say that. I command you to go out now. Get out of there right now. Come out.
Come out.
There you go. Get mad at him. Just get mad at him. Come out now.
Get out.
One. Fight like that. Good.
Get out of here.
Crank it.
Get out of here. Get out.
Fight.
Get out. I can rebuke. I have already rebuked and repented of the thoughts and things I've said and things I believe that I have in God. But I still. I am not being rebellious in any way. But I still have that. The way I view God, I don't know how to change it. That way that I see God. How can I, that's what keeps me apart from God.
The way you see Him is when you read the Bible, you don't really believe that. You don't see Him that way, you see Him the way you see Him.
See Him through the Bible.
Yeah. You don't, this is the way you're supposed to see Him.
I don't see Him through my thinking of
God. Exactly. Yeah, thank you.
Yeah. So read the Bible more.
Well, reading it is okay, but you got to believe what you're reading there. You got to believe that. Like, if you read John 14 tonight, chapter 14.
Because the thing is that I'm just explaining to you. The way that I was thinking about hell, I was thinking about the people, all of those things. That's the image that I got of God.
Yeah.
So just forget okay. about those things. Forget about my logical no. viewpoint of God based on facts and on things and hell and people and no. all those things.
That's not going to work. You are reading about hell, and that's good, but hell is put in perspective of the whole truth of God. That's only a portion of it. And hell's got nothing to do with you. Why are you focusing on hell when it has nothing to do with you? Why couldn't you just sit down and read John chapter 14 and just believe that tonight? Not just read it, but actually believe it.
How I grab parts of the Bible I need to work on my relationship with God. I don't know why you're getting frustrated. I'm starting to work this out with you.
I'm getting frustrated because your whole family's going to hell in a handbasket. And we've been working with you for 2 years. I want you to just No.
Yes, I am.
Okay, I don't believe you. All I'm asking you to do is just John 14.
Well, you could be a little bit more patient with me, too. I wouldn't work.
2 years is... Son, I've been patient with your whole family. We've spent hours working with everybody in this family. Hours working with you. I'm working with you right now when I should be praying for all these other people. Your view of God is negative. Okay? Nobody in their right mind sees God as negative.
I'm just trying to get to a point. That's what I'm trying to get. I'm trying to get to the bottom of this. I'm trying to understand this because apparently my mind may be focused on something else, maybe skewed.
So your mind, now you're on the right track.
I'm trying to get to the bottom of this. I have a good will to get out of this.
Okay, your mind is skewed, so we agree on that. So now to unskew it, you have to look at John 14 and just go, this is what it says, and that's the truth, and what I think is wrong. So I'm going to trash what I think, and I'm going to receive that. Now, what's wrong with that? What's wrong with what I just said? You'll do that then. Okay. We'll do that.
I bind it. I bind you, it and cast it out to diabetes. And now I'm in this one for going more.
No, your diabetes, we went over that 5 times too. Your diabetes is related to your negative emotions in your soul. You can't just bind diabetes and cast it out and then keep the negative emotions in your soul. They feed off each other. This one feeds on that one. They all go together. Yes. Worry, fear, anxiety. That is keeping the diabetes dug in like an Alabama tick. You can't cast diabetes out of somebody. You have to go to the root of it.
So then I got to bind anxiety, fear.
Yes. Yeah. And those things are caused by thoughts.
Some things take time. And I'm doing my best to get to the
bottom. Some things take time. Let's start tonight then. Let's start tonight then and start over now. We'll start.
I have an open heart. I know this takes time and this takes a lot of things. But I have an open heart. I want to change. And that's all I have to say. I want to change. I have an open heart.
Okay, well then you got to. Now, if she feels that way, then she can be healed. Anybody who has that attitude can be healed. God treats everybody the same. He treats them all the same. God is no respect.
We actually want to get better. We don't want to get worse. We're doing our best. It may look like we're not trying, but we're actually trying our best to get out of this. We actually want to get better. And that's what I'm trying to say. We're not.
Okay.
I don't want to be stubborn. I'm not trying to be stubborn.
But something was failing. We're just trying to help. Yes. Because it's not enough how good wishes. I mean, it's not enough. Have good wishes.
We need
wishes are useless.
Yeah.
Wishes are useless. No, there's no wishes in the Bible. So that's in fairy tales.
I would start binding out of those.
You're going to catch those negative, fearful, anxiety thoughts, and you're going to repent of keeping them in your heart. Remember that list I gave you? All you had to do was go down that list.
Yeah.
Actually, did all those things in that list.
Everyone in the list, every person that you don't like, okay? Your dad, your stepdad, put on that list, and then you pray for your stepdad. See?
I wrote a list of every person.
Did you put your stepdad on it?
I put everyone.
Okay, and then did you do it until? Do you have any bad feelings about your stepdad anymore?
What?
Do you have any bad feelings about your stepdad anymore? Okay, well, see, he didn't do it. So you go back to number one, and you stay on that until there's no more negative feelings about him.
I mean, I did everything in the list. I did everything step by step. I prayed, and I forget every single person in that list.
Okay, now when you forgave your stepdad, do you still have any negative emotions and feelings about your stepdad?
At the moment, I didn't. But when things happen during the day...
Okay, well then he took it back. Okay, now you're the son, you're the stepson, and he's the mother, and he's the stepdad, okay? Their relationship is none of your business. You are not supposed to be butting into their business. So when you butt into their business, now you hate the stepdad. You get mad at him. So then, boop, you can't get healed. The devil is tricking you. He's outsmarting you every step of the way. Your husband is between you and your husband, not him.
So he's going to take up that sword. He's going to take up that sword now.
Yeah, see? So every time he gets mad at him again, boom, now the liver's going.
What? It's extremely tough.
Oh, your demons and sin are tough. You're absolutely well spoken. That was divinely inspired. This whole thing is tough. Ask the preacher here. He knows more than I do about it. This whole thing is tough. But you have to repent and change. Buddy.
I need a way to bring it to my brother. Also, I need to be here.
Did you bring somebody here?
What'd
you say?
Just my mom.
Oh, okay.
Brother Mike, thank you so much. It was divinely inspired because
love you.
Everything that's been going on, brother. Thank you for bringing it. Look, bro.
Stay on the wheel. Who else needs prayer down
here? There's this lady right here, Mike. She's so messed up. She got raped. See, this guy dragged her.
Who did?
And I got her friend dragged her here, but she got raped. I got her to forgive her once she's received that part. But then now the spirit's growling in her head, and she thought I was growling.
This lady here? This girl?
Yes.
Come here. Hey, what's that girl's name? Who are you?
Elena. I'm Blake.
You're with her?
Yeah.
Oh, Elena. Elena, hi, sweetheart. Come here, sweetie. Hey, Mike. How are you? Yeah, nice to meet you. I'm Mike. You Elena? Yeah, what do you need from the Lord tonight? You need help? What kind of help? He's an expert at giving people help. Tell me what you need.
I thought he was growling at me.
No, he wasn't. That was the demon. He was trying to help you. He cares about you. Now, what demon was growling at you? Who did it? Were you into witchcraft in the past? Were anybody ever put a curse on you?
Come on.
Were you ever on drugs? What kind of drugs?
Marijuana.
Did you smoke a lot of pot? Okay. Now, are you a Christian?
I like to think I am.
Okay. Okay, now let's do that first, okay? Now let's make sure you're a Christian. Raise your hands and close your eyes. Atta girl. Lord, we bring this beautiful woman to you right now. We hand her to you. She needs to be born again. She needs to receive the Holy Spirit. And that demon that was growling in her brain, he is listening to me right now. Hey, I know you're in there. He's listening to me right now, and he does not belong in there. And she's going to turn her heart over to the Lord Jesus, the Son of the living God. Right now. She's going to do it right now. And she's going to pray just like this. You pray with me in your mind. Lord Jesus, I'm so sorry. I committed adultery and took drugs and smoked pot. And I cursed and swore and I lived in sin. And I am sorry for that because I sinned and I opened up a door to the spirit world. And some spirit got into my body. He's growling tonight. And he wants to take me to hell. And I don't want to go to hell. I want to go with you. So Lord Jesus, please forgive me right now. Please have mercy on me right now, Lord. Help me right now. Forgive me for what I've done. I'm turning my life over to you, and I'm leaving my old life behind 100% tonight. Right now. Right now I'm going to do it. Come on, sweetie, do it. Say it. Do it. Lord Jesus, I'm yours. Pray harder, honey. Come on now. You're supposed to get healed tonight. This is a house of healing. Come on, the Lord loves you. He likes you. He wants to be with you. But you got to confess it. The Bible says if you confess your sins, God is faithful and just, and he will forgive you of your sins. Now just confess it. Say it. Say it so that demon that growls can hear you.
Come on, just do what I tell you. I've done this before. This is my business. Just follow my lead here. I know my business. Lord Jesus, I am sorry. Just say that. Come on, sweetie. You got to get saved tonight. You have to turn your life over to the Lord. That thing growling in your head, he's going to finish you off down the road. Let me tell you something. I know him. He's ugly. And he hates your guts. You should have done everything Preacher Rick told you to do. Everything he told you to do, you should have done everything when he told you to do it. He was trying to help you and he cares about you. He wasn't growling. That was that spirit in your head growling. Now, come on, let's go. Lord Jesus, I'm yours. Come see me now, Lord. Come see me right now. Holy Spirit, touch me right now. Just say a simple prayer like that. Those are the best ones, the simple ones. Son, can you hear me? I'm praying out loud so you can hear me. Can you hear me? You do. You pray. Come on. Yeah, you need to pray. Bad, don't you? Are you saved?
Yes.
You sure? Okay. What do you need from the Lord?
Well, I've already been delivered by Valerie and stuff.
Oh, you did? Okay. Is that your girlfriend? Who is she?
She's my friend, Elena.
What's wrong with her?
It's pretty personal, but...
Yeah, what? Lord, Mr. Henderson, I want you to forgive him for what he'd done to her. I want you to forgive him. Wherever he is tonight, no matter where he is. The Bible says if we don't forgive other people their trespasses, God will not forgive our trespasses. And so I am asking you, Lord, forgive him, and so is she. Just forgive him right now. Right now, forgive him. Just forgive him. Just forgive him. What he did to her, we command that evil spirit that transferred in there, get out of that body right now. Go now. Get out of there. Growly, I know you can hear me. Come out of that body right now. I know you can hear me. Get out of that body right now. There he is. Here he comes. Come out of that body right now. You can't have her. I know you think you have her. You think you have her? I know that. I know what you're thinking. Come out right now. Get out of that body right now, you pervert, you rapist. You pervert, you come out of there. That is not her. That's you doing that. That's not you. Get out of that body. Tell him to go, honey. I command the spirit that's growling in my head to come out now. Right now. Whoa, there he is. Come out. Come out of there. Uh-oh. Here he comes. Come out right now. Come out right now. There he comes. Come out of there. Come out in the name of Jesus Christ. Let's go. Come out of there. Come out right now. Come out. Come out of there. Come out. Come on out. Come out right now. Come out right now. Go now. Come out, you pervert. Henderson. Henderson. Mr. Henderson, in the name of Jesus Christ, be forgiven and come out. Right now. Go now. Who needs prayer over here before we close? Streamers, put your hand on your body. Put your hand on your chest and your body. What you have to do is use your authority in Christ to take command over the spirits in your body and the ones in your brain. If you used to smoke pot, you were a heavy pot smoker, that thing lets in spirits in your brain like you wouldn't believe. The spirits just float in. And pretty soon you have memory deficits, concentration deficits. You have blocks in your memory. You got chunks of your childhood you can't remember. All of a sudden, this pot spirit gets in your mind and he starts to suck memories out. And then he gives you concentration problems. Okay? You got to put your hand on your head, just like this. Put your hand on your head. Father, in the name of Jesus, I renounce drugs, alcohol, pot. I renounce taking these drugs to cover up wounds on my soul, sin in my life. I'm sorry for doing that, Lord. And I repent right now in the name of Jesus of taking these drugs. And I bind these spirits, Matthew chapter 18. And I take authority over them, Luke chapter 10. And I bind you, you spirit, in my brain.
Put your hand on your head, streamers. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, I command you now, come out now. Come out of my head in Jesus' holy name. Come out right now. Go now out of my brain. Come out of my brain right now in the name of the Lord. If you have cancer like this lady over here had, that cancer spirit came out of her. That lady was over here in the corner. She's still here or she go? What happened to that lady who was over here in the corner? She just left. She had cancer and some chunk or something came right out of her chest. You just put your hands on your body. In Mark chapter 16, streamers, the Bible says, these signs shall follow them that believe. In my name they shall cast out demons. In my name they shall lay hands on the sick and they shall recover. You can lay hands on your own body. You can lay hands on your own body or someone that you love. You put your hands on them like that in Jesus' name and command that spirit of infirmity, cancer, tuberculosis, whatever the disease is, you can command that spirit to come out of your body. You put your hands wherever that thing is. Put your hands where the pain is. You got an old injury here in your knees, injury in your hips. You got pains in your low back. Put your hand right back there, streamers, and command that spirit of infirmity to come out in the name of the Lord. Now, just like Robert said, now in Jesus' mighty name. Come out now in Jesus' holy name. Let him have it. Come out now. Robert will lead you right now. Come out in Jesus' Lord.
Come out of my body.
Go
right
now.
Spirit of
streamers,
pain.
You go to the website, hardcorechristianity.com.
Right,
you hit the post-deliverance button. Post-deliverance at the top. Hit the post-deliverance button at the top.
In the name of Jesus.
And follow that 10-step program so you don't get reinfected or lose your healing.
In the name of Jesus. Stand up. Come on.
Go to the teaching button. The teaching button at the top.
Let's go. Come on.
And read the article on how Satan controls the mind.
Okay, you talk to your body right now. You tell them to come out
right now. Read the article. Satan's counterattack.
What?
You have to use your authority.
Pain come out of my body right now.
You have to receive the gift of
pain. Pain come out of my lower back right now.
And you have to fight back. You must fight back.
In the name of Jesus.
Prayer
alone
does not work.
Pain come out of my body right now.
You pray about it first.
Pain come out of my knee. By faith walk
you fight.
Move
first you pray.
Move
then you fight.
Move
Jesus taught us that. First he prayed
cancer
on the mountain.
Come out of my body right
then
now.
He came down and fought.
Lying spirit.
You pray first, then you fight. Then you use your authority. Just like the Lord Jesus taught us. You pray in your prayer closet. You get the anointing in your prayer closet. Then you come out of your prayer closet in a bad mood, ready to fight. That is how you win. Demons will not roll over because you've been praying a couple of casual prayers. Dinner prayers don't work in spiritual warfare. You must repent. You must surrender. You must fight back. If you do not fight back, you will not be healed. You will not be delivered. That's how it works. This is not rocket science. This isn't rocket science. If you keep saying negative things or you keep repeating negativity, you are cursing yourself, you are cursing others.
Yes.
You will never be healed, you will never be well.
Yes.
James chapter 3. You must change what you're talking. What you must change, how you believe. Like this girl here, she's being healed. Be healed. Thank you, Jesus. This lady's getting healed
right
here. What's wrong with her? What's wrong with this lady? Huh? Oh, hips here. I'll show you how to do the hips. Stand up, hon. Now, whenever you have a hip issue, you stand the person up there. And then you find out where the top of their pelvis bone is.
Okay.
So just find the top of the pelvis bone. Where is that, hon? Where is it at there? Show me, honey. Where is it at? Oh, there. Is that it right there?
Yeah.
Okay. Is this it?
Yeah.
Okay, ready? Now, Lord, I ask you right now in the name of Jesus to level these hips out.
Yes.
Level them out, I pray. There you go. There you go. Level out. And we bind the spirit of infirmity in the name of Jesus. There it goes. Rotate out. Hips rotate in. Rotate. Spirit of pain, I bind your power and it come out.
Lord.
Come out of that body right now. Heel. Rotate those hips. I can't tell if she's straightened out yet or not. How are you feeling? What is going on in there? You sensed anything? Or nothing? Anything happen? I can't see what's... Any change? What's she saying? What?
Yes, there is.
What's she saying?
Better.
Any change at all?
Yeah.
What happened? How did you hurt yourself before? Do you have an accident or something? Does she speak English? Does she speak English? You know her? You know her?
Bruised
bone? Where? There? Okay. Oh, okay. Oh, okay. Now, when you were younger, did you ever hate anybody? When you were younger, did you ever hate anybody?
No.
Did you ever hate yourself? Did you ever hate yourself? Yeah, now, that's going to block your healing, so go ahead and repent of that. Just repent of hating yourself. Go ahead. God, forgive me for hating myself. Streamers, listen to me. You cannot hate yourself and get healed. If you hate yourself, you got bad feelings about yourself, man, you are screwed. That is going to block your anointing, your ministry, your healing, everything. You have to be able to forgive yourself because God has forgiven you. And He does not have bad feelings about you. You must come over to His side and think the way He thinks. God requires us to renew our minds and think with the mind of Christ. The mind of Christ is this, streamers. God is not mad at you anymore. God does not have any bad thoughts about you. He does not dislike you. He loves you. He's 100% in your corner. If you have bad feelings about yourself and you won't let go of your bad choices and your regrets and all the crap in your life, hey, what do you need, hon? You need something from God? Nothing? If you won't give up the bad things in your life that you've held against yourself, you cannot be healed. Okay? So, streamers, just pray with me right now. Lord, I got bad feelings about myself and bad feelings about other people, abusers, critics, negative people. People said negative things about me. I hated myself because I made bad choices. And I just repent of it. I repent right this second. I'm repenting right now. I repent. And I forgive. I forgive myself. I'm going to do it. I want to forgive myself. Thank you, Jesus. I'm forgiving myself right this second. Did you do it? Is it you better or worse? You're better. Okay. If you will forgive yourself, your body then will flow with God's word and His healing power, and then the body just mends quickly. It'll mend. But if you got any stinky stuff for yourself, that will plug it up like somebody corking in a wine bottle. It just plugs it right up. If I can get the person to forgive themselves or the other person or release them, you wouldn't believe how fast people can get healed. It's weird. It's unbelievable. I've seen so many people, hundreds. I've seen hundreds of people get healed right in front of my eyes because they pulled that plug on themselves. Pulled that plug on themselves. If you had multiple marriages, you have developed multiple levels of self-hatred, hatred for others. Multiple marriages will kill you. The person gets worse and worse and worse, okay? You got to go right back down the line. Release and forgive every one of those people in Jesus' mighty name. Tuesday night at 7 o'clock, I'll be right here for our deliverance training class. You wouldn't believe the people getting delivered in that class. It's fantastic. And all those teachings will be on YouTube on the deliverance training channel. You can watch all of them free. I'll be here Tuesdays and Fridays. Wednesdays and Thursdays, we also have healing teaching and deliverance here at 7 o'clock. God bless you.
God bless you.
How'd that go?